Well, I think Gordon has proved that it's extremely difficult to see a golden eagle close up in the wild, which is a real shame because they're fabulous birds to see. And we thought you might like to see one, so we've cheated just a little bit. And we've brought in a captive bred golden eagle. She's absolutely beautiful. She's called Orla and she's come in from the Loch Lomond Bird of Prey Centre. And I would imagine she's pretty heavy, eh, Chris?
Pretty heavy. Under her arm there? Pretty heavy. About 5.5 kilograms, slightly more than an obese Shih Tzu or Pekingese. That's the sort of weight we're talking about. But do you know, I've got a new girl in my life. What can you say? It's such an impressive bird. She's in beautiful condition as well. Absolutely stunning.
And to have a captive one like this allows us to look at all the different features and just look at those talons. They are so strong.
They are.
Now, you think of the prey that a golden eagle would go for, anything from a small bird to a rabbit, a hare, even a fox. Once they've caught it, they've then got to hold it and fly off with it. And this time of the year, though, they go more for carrion, dead deer and sheep, and they'll need those talons to rip the meat off.
Look at those talons.
Extremely powerful.
Hugely powerful. Hugely powerful. And the beak as well. Not so much for killing. They do the killing with their feet, but for tearing things up. And that carrion you mentioned, well, this has got to open a red deer hide, maybe a dried red deer hide, a frozen red deer hide. So that's why they've got such a powerful beak. But look, let's take a look at the wings. A wingspan of 1.8 to 2.2 metres. And if I just gently rock her,
look at the size of her.
Look at that. Absolutely fantastic. About 440 pairs, you know, Michaela, left in the UK. About 5% of Europe's population. Goodness me, what a treat.
I think everyone would agree that this is a beautiful bird. It's actually what we call a sexy A-lister. It's stunning and it's exotic. But what about the small stuff? Let's not forget the little things that live in your garden. They may not be sexy, but delve into the log pile and you'll see a fascinating world. There's little respite from the weather in winter, but tucked into the corner of the garden is a safe house for wildlife. Protected from the extremes outside, a chrysalis. Of the UK's 59 species of butterfly, the majority spend the winter in this state. And tucked up between the bark, a queen wasp sleeps. Wings folded under her body for protection, she'll hibernate until the temperature rises in the spring. And still deeper, hidden at the base of the log pile, a slug has laid a clutch of eggs. Slugs lay up to 400 eggs a year in batches of 50. During the colder autumn and winter, these will take a few months to develop and hatch. But not everything sleeps through the winter. And when food is scarce, these protein-packed microbites provide a tasty meal for a host of garden creatures, including a hungry centipede. Centipedes generally hunt moving prey, and the front pair of legs is adapted into pincer-like venom-injecting claws called forcipules. These not only help capture prey, but they're also perfect for grasping and piercing. Temperatures in the log pile can be several degrees higher than those outside, meaning that it's not just centipedes that are out and about. Delve into the gloom, and the barren becomes the busy. Violet ground beetles generally hibernate in winter, but living here means they can stay on the move. Having gorged on slug eggs, our centipede returns to the hunt. Its name means 100 foot, but in fact some have as few as 20 legs, whilst others as many as 300. All perfectly synchronized to ensure they don't get entangled. The flattened body is perfect for moving between the logs and twigs of this 3D world.
Living in the dark holds no fear for this beast either, for centipedes don't have true vision. They can only detect light and dark, and rely instead on their sensitive antennae to search for food. Buried elsewhere, more eggs. But unlike those of the slug, these have an advantage. Their attentive mother is never far away. Female earwigs are the domestic goddesses of the insect world. Having kicked out the father while she was pregnant, this single mother lays a bundle of up to 80 eggs in early December. In this dank, damp world, her eggs are prone to fungal infection, and so each day she carefully turns and cleans the surface of the eggs to ensure that they stay healthy. The centipede senses food is nearby. The mother detects danger. She uses her pincer-like cerci to defend against any intruders, even those much larger than herself. Unusually for an insect, earwig mothers never leave their eggs and will make the ultimate sacrifice in order to protect them. Today, however, victory is hers. But that doesn't stop her playing it safe. She moves her eggs to a more protected spot. A female will sustain this level of care until the eggs hatch. If the winter proves a cold one, that could be for as long as 4 months. So this winter, spare a thought for the hidden metropolis in the corner of your garden.
Well, here we are on the second part of our whistle stop tour, and we've come down to the forest. Look at this gorgeous Scots pine. Actually, before we go on, that earwig, what a bit like buffed and polished amber, definitely my favourite insect. Right, in the woods here, Scots pine, it's classic habitat, and it's got its very own flora and fauna. We'll examine that a bit. It's incredibly wet at the moment. Because of all the rain we've been having, this place is absolutely drenched. Anyway, come up here. Yes, there's lots of specialist animals here, and they leave clues behind. We're going to do a little bit of detective work now, if I can see what I'm doing. And it involves pine cones. And there's a standard pine cone. And here, that was a pine cone. But that's a classic sign of an animal that's in here, in these woods. It's the red squirrel. Red squirrels, absolutely beautiful things. They're about half the size of the greys. They used to be all over the country. But this time of year, they're usually solitary, but you'll see them together. You'll see the grey squirrels together. You may have seen that at home. And that's because they're starting their breeding season. This is the display, the courtship. You'll see them whizzing round and round trees. They're absolutely lovely little creatures. And those little ear tufts they've got there, they only grow those in winter, so in summer, they disappear. Red squirrels, lovely. Now here is another pine cone. Let me see if I can, yes, there it is. You can see it's been split. I don't know if you can see that, it's been split there. Now that wasn't done by my penknife, I promise. That was done by another iconic bird here. The bird is a crossbill. And we can see how it did that. Here's the crossbill, weird-looking beak that, which is literally twisted over, and it uses that specifically to open these pine cones. You can see it, it's cracked it open, and it's extracting the seed there. There you go. That's the crossbill. Oh, I've lost my torch now. Come with me, because we're just going to... I want you to just allow your imagination to flow now and look up into these trees. Imagine that there was... You were up in those trees, because in holes in the trees, you might find another, a third iconic animal here, and that is the pine marten, because they love to... They're very arboreal, they're often up in trees, and they'll sleep, they'll have a little den up there. So, we know we've got pine martens, we've got crossbills, we've got red squirrels here as well. What else have we got? Well, we're going to try and find out, and I'm going to show you this quickly. You may remember these. This is a trap... Just whack me. This is a way of finding out what's around here. What happens is that little things run in, they put their feet in this ink, and then they'll leave us a little sign. So we'll come back, we'll set these all over the place, and we'll try and find out what else is around here. So, anyway, we're going off now. We're heading off down to the river. You're heading off back to Chris and Michaela. See you later. Oops!
Oops! Do you know, I feel a little bit guilty that he's out in, you know, in the wilds with the weather. It's much colder up there, and we're coming into our cosy cabin. We've even got a cup of coffee waiting for us.
I feel about that guilty.
No heart.
Now, winter is the time when a lot of our wildlife struggles to find food, and there's no greater evidence for this than looking at your bird feeders. They are very busy at this time of year. A great range of species will be coming in. And the reason they're so busy is that these birds are concerned about their bioenergetics. It's about the acquisition and expenditure of energy. Now, during the daytime, they will have to spend 85% of their time looking for food. We've got short days, remember, as well. And species like blue tits, well, they weigh 11 grams. They need to eat 10 grams a day because they lose 5% of their body weight overnight. You see, they can't stock up and become robust, take on lots of fat like some animals, because then they'd be very vulnerable to predators. So they've got to take on that food every single day, which means that choosing the right food is incredibly important.
And it's thought that during the winter, those birds suss out the best sources of food in people's gardens and then go back to those sources of food just before it gets dark so they can stock up for the night. But it's something that Oxford University want to explore more about, and they want you to get involved. So we want as many people as possible this week to get involved in a bird table experiment. What is the experiment? Well, let me explain. So when your garden birds have to fuel up at the end of the day, what food would they prefer? Something sweet, like a bit of fruit, or something fatty, like a bit of cheese? Well, there's only one way to find out, and that's to do a little experiment. Over the next 3 days, we're going to test this by changing the bird's menu. So day one, put out your normal bird seed. Sprinkle that on the table. To get an idea of the number of birds that normally visit your feeders in the afternoon, you need to count them, and Oxford University need everyone to count in the same structured way. So you watch for 3 minutes, see which birds come down, mark them down. If you know the species, that's great. If you don't, just put unknown. Put the numbers, and then you take 7 minutes off and go make a cup of tea. After a cuppa, count again for 3 minutes. Wait for seven, and then do a third and final count. At the end of day one, you clear away your normal bird food. And then you put out food ready for the day two experiment, and that's either going to be cheese or apple. Now, if your surname is A to L, you put out cheese. If it's M to Z, like mine, Strachan, you put out apple. On day two, do the 3 minute counts in exactly the same way. So at the end of day two, take away whatever's left on the bird table and put out the food ready for day three. For me, that's cheese, but remember, if your surname is A to L, that's going to be apple.